from Studio 13 in California. You're listening to Wildcard with your hosts, John.
That's because our generation is awesome. Allow me to introduce Exhibit Douche.
Yeah. And Connor.
I was born in the end of 1981, and I am a millennial.
A show that is blowing up on MySpace.
Hello, and welcome to this episode of Wildcard. In this show, we get in touch with our inner grumpier old man. We spend nearly the entire show proving why our generation is clearly the best. It's scientific. More specifically, we deep dive into the steaming pile of garbage that is YouTube star Jake Paul, his zany antics, and his not terrible at all rap song. I mean, after all, he's a Cali boy, but like actually totally from Cleveland. We have our first girl on, we talk about eating cricket taint and how it's good for the environment, and finally we make fun of the millennials some more. So if you're easily triggered, think PewDiePie is lit, you might want to say, I can't even, and stop listening now. It's another episode of Wildcard. I want to welcome back Captain of Medical Mysteries, Connor Johnston. Because we've done it in the past, I will forego the medical check-in, mostly because I've recently eaten a meal. So I had quite a day. I have to admit I'm grumpy, although I'm wondering if I'm getting grumpier simply because of my age. Like, is this kind of just becoming a constant state of being? But I like to blame it on the social media and the millennials.
Okay.
Like many problems, and many people do. Because it's, I'm doing...
It's good to scapegoat.
Is it really scapegoating if they're actually to blame?
You got me there. Touché.
I've got... I'm doing my best to grow the show. And yes. This is where we'll throw in kind of the public access, you know, the pledge drives.
Yeah.
So this is where I say to people, hey, if you tell a friend about the show, this is how we grow. And if you tell two friends, we triple our audience in 1 week.
And we'll send you a calendar of 2017.
There you go.
Yeah, there's always a prize. Great prizes.
I think our audience is actually not smart enough to realize why that's not an effective
prize. Are you looking for a deck of 51 playing cards?
I'm trying to grow the show on the social medias. And because I'm old and not hip, mm-hmm. I'm having to do all these things that I feel like my Google browser thinks I'm a 12-year-old girl now, because I'm Googling all this asinine crap like... How to get famous on Instagram, and you know, how to grow your social following and how to get likes, because I want the show to get out there. I want people to hear our mediocre comedy. And it reminded me how much I hate social media and everything that it encompasses. And I came across someone who I knew I hated, but I didn't realize how much I hated them until I deep dove a little more. Are you familiar with someone named Jake Paul?
Is that the guy who had the MTV show? Wait.
I don't know if he has an MTV show.
There's an Aaron Paul. Aaron Paul.
No, that's Breaking Bad.
There's this kid who looks like a 14-year-old that just like overnight got awkwardly big, but also has some like donkey genes in him. He just kind of has a donkey face. I guess kind of good looking in a donkey kind of way. But he had a show for a hot second on MTV. He was the one who had the controversy where he went to Japan.
Okay, we are thinking of the same person.
So you're talking about the younger brother.
So there are multiple societal hemorrhoid Pauls. You've got a Jake Paul.
Yeah.
And you've got a brother, Logan Paul.
Logan Paul. Thank you. Yes. You were right about the bad drugs.
Yeah.
Yes.
They're basically both cesspools of human beings.
But you see what I'm talking about with the kind of donkey features?
Yeah, no, that's why when you started describing him and you said donkey-esque,
yeah.
it is. So his history is he's a Disney kid. And everyone hates everyone. Does anyone not hate a precocious kid? You know, you see them when they're like 9 on the Today Show and they're just like way too happy and kind of overzealous. And you're like, I'm going to hate you so much when you go through puberty.
Everything is going so right for you. And it just really bothers me.
Because, yeah. They've been on Ellen like 4 times and they're so fun.
Yeah.
And you're just like, once you go through puberty and get a giant Instagram following, you are going to be an awful, awful person.
And I can't even complete that like 70-piece puzzle that's meant for 6-year-olds. And you're on TV with Ellen.
Obnoxious. Where they're like identifying like the capital of Azerbaijan.
Yeah.
And they're like 5, and you're just like, I hate you. I can't even spell different.
Yeah, and like your kid doesn't know what street you live on.
My kid plays with his own feces. That's where we are.
Yeah, that's fair. Wait, I wanted to ask you something. You said Disney kid. Are you talking about that Disney show that Britney Spears and Justin Timberlake and who was the other one, the Dreamboat, that was on there?
No, I don't know if you know this, but I know this from watching American Idol the other night because I'm awesome and I'm gayer than you are.
Yeah.
They had to sing songs of the year of their birth. And one of the kids up there was, I think, in college, and she sang a Britney Spears song.
Yeah.
So these kids are way... Britney Spears and the Justin Timberlake are older now.
Yeah. No, they're the seasoned professionals.
But I digress. So back to this...
the donkey kid.
Yes.
Yeah.
This is Jake Paul.
Yeah.
So the guy has 14 million plus YouTube subscribers. He is basically the biggest thing on YouTube. He makes, I don't know, $15, $20, $30 million a year.
Do you think so? Are they really monetizing that?
Oh yeah. At that level, when you've got 14 million subscribers, absolutely.
How many million subscribers do we have? Are you holding out on me? Where's my money?
Okay, I'm not done with this guy because I've got a lot on this guy and I'm a little bit annoyed at myself for going down this rabbit hole, but I couldn't help it. I got so excited over what a colossal douche this guy is. He released a song, so he got really famous off of his videos, and I'll tell you more about that. He released a song called It's Every Day, Bro.
Okay.
He calls everyone bro.
Yeah.
His term is what the flip, like instead of what the fuck, he's like, what the flip, bro?
Yeah, that was...
Like he gets tough guy?
When they used to air The Breakfast Club on TV, there was a scene where Emilio Estevez would say, fuck you, and they would change it to flip you because it was TV.
Pretty much, exactly.
If Emilio does it, it's cool.
The bad voiceover?
Yeah, it's like, hey man, flip you.
I guess what annoys me so much is... This guy is like if Jackass, because Jackass was our generation and Jackass was awesome.
Yeah.
If Jackass had no creativity and no nuts, they would be Jake Paul.
Okay.
His big gag is that he goes to people's houses, like celebrity houses, and he gets a for sale sign, like the kind you get at Home Depot, like mm-hmm. to sell your car.
Yeah.
And his gag is they drive around, they Google where these famous people's houses are, Kim Kardashian, or one of the videos I pulled up here is Donald Trump's, I guess, has a house somewhere in Southern California. And they drive out there and they run up to the fence. They don't even break in. They go to the fence and they stick the for sale sign on the fence. And they're like, your house is for sale, bro. And then they go like, run, run, run. And he's like 22 years old, and he's like running and they're jumping in their car like, security's coming. And that is the gag, and he does it like 6 or 7 times a week to different celebrities' houses, and these 12 year olds eat this up, and it makes me want to never stop punching him in the face.
So this brings up several important points. How can we steal his thunder and come up with antics that are as ingenious as that? Because clearly he's doing something right and we're doing something wrong.
But that's what's...
What can we put up for sale?
I don't know if copying that is going to work when you're in your late 30s.
Look, man, if he's got 14 million followers being the original, we can knock that off and get at least 2 or 3. I'm perfectly happy copying the Donkey Kid.
Well, here, let me play you a clip from... this is Donald Trump's house.
Okay.
Allow me to play a clip for you. About how wicked awesome and daredevil he is.
Do we have to pay royalties for this?
Fuck him.
Look at the guy here. Look at they're both right here.
So he's breaking into Donald, or not breaking in. He's standing outside of Donald Trump's house.
They're going to deport you. Guys, clearly.
So he's got two friends with him who are foreign. I don't know who they are because I don't know who Jake Paul is. But he literally says he's going to deport you every 30 seconds. He just can't.
That was the gag he wanted to make sure he got in for the day.
That's his zinger.
Yeah.
He isn't here because the Secret Service would be like surrounding this whole place. Should I see if I can touch the pool? All right, ready? Guys, I'm gonna yell, Donald, I love you. And then we run, okay? Get ready to run.
Yeah.
Donald! Donald, I love you! Go, oh, I'm stuck.
They're now running away from the house.
Get in the car.
So they stood on the fence.
Turn the inside.
Really?
Go. Drive. We love you, Donald. The Martinez twins can stay. Woo! Look at these cameras that they have outside of his house.
Oh, there's
look
the
at
for
the,
sale
oh,
sign.
The sign. Oh,
I was gonna make an offer.
Woo!
We did it. High five.
Martinez twins, you can stay.
Yeah. We did it. High five. Right. So that was the zinger. 8.5 million views.
So that video is
that makes him like $1 million. That made him $1 million. This is why I hate the new generation. I hate them for this.
So let me ask you a question. And before I ask my question,
okay.
The young men in this video, they are of age. They are over 18.
Sure. They look over 18.
Okay, good. At any point in this 14-minute video, do they start giving each other hand whammies on film?
Well, what you're talking about is porn, and to me, that's kind of a completely different ballgame.
But that's my point. Porn would be better than this.
Yes. This is marketed at 12-year-olds. It has to be. Dear God, I hope. The only thing I can think of is that for a 12-year-old, this is as crazy an idea as they could ever imagine themselves doing. And so they can somehow relate to this as being like crazy nuts.
So let's just be clear for the folks who can't see. What these three yahoos did is they went to the fence, the exterior of a house that looks unoccupied, stood up on the lowest ledge of the fence, yelled, "I love you," and then ran back to their car all wheezy like they just did something cool and awesome.
Wild car, bitches!
And they ran yelling, "Watch out for security. Look at all these security cameras."
Right, which were probably not even plugged in.
And then Jake Paul said, "Should I jump the fence and do you dare me to touch the pool?"
Right, neither of which he did.
And then he did not do that. Yes.
Yeah.
Why can't we get Steve-O launching a bottle rocket out of his anus? That is grade A material.
And again, we bring this up not to hate on what they're doing, but to reflect on the injustice of the fact that we don't have 14 million followers and they do.
Oh, I'm not going to try to deny that I don't have a ton of jealousy wrapped up in this.
Oh, I am seething with jealousy right now.
Oh, but let's look at the beginning of the video.
If it sounds like I am making fun of these kids, please know that that is coming out of a feeling of profound inadequacy.
So here's the beginning, and he's holding up a Zap.
Is that a stun finder?
It is a stun gun.
Oh.
So I'm like, okay, shit just got real.
Yeah.
The Jake Paul has a stun gun.
That was how Johnny Knoxville first got a bunch of attention.
Yes.
Is he put on medieval armor, and he had, I don't even remember who it was, if it was like Steve-O or his mom or something, shot him with a crossbow and then like a 9mm, and that was...
That's because our generation is awesome.
Yeah.
Now, allow me to introduce Exhibit Douche.
Granted, don't do those things.
Wake up!
Lest you confuse that noise, he is holding it in their general vicinity.
And pushing the button.
But not actually electrocuting
them. And it's not one of those tasers where the thing shoots out and hits you. He's just holding it 5 feet away from them. And he basically has a bug zapper. You know those things hang on your porch?
Oh, but it gets better. Because that was zany as hell.
That was super zany. Oh, he bleaches his hair.
Good for him. Good morning.
So in that scene, he pretended to wake himself up with the bug zapper.
Because he had fallen asleep on the floor, it looked like. And
it wasn't well thought out.
Was that in the mud room of his mansion that he bought?
Oh, so this house is actually kind of a big thing because he's got this mansion in the Hollywood Hills because he makes
hella
dope, yo.
He didn't buy this. I don't think he bought this. The story is he rented this house where they film their zany videos. You're shaking your head, but I saw this on Henry Stossel. He rented this house somewhere in L.A. and was filming his zany videos, and the neighbors wanted to fucking strangle him.
The neighbors have a point because...
Oh, yeah, they have a point.
One of his other zany tricks, because he's so irreverent, he decided to take all of the cheap IKEA furniture that he furnished this $10 million mansion with and the bunk beds in the living room that has his friend Douches sleeping on. And he took it all one night because they were crazy hopped up on Mountain Dew. Mm-hmm. And they threw all the furniture out in the foyer and they burned it. And so imagine you're living in the Hollywood Hills. You've done something right in your life, right? You've worked your ass off. You're probably like a lawyer with cases, probably got 3 ex-wives, a bunch of alimony, kids that are as big a douche as Jake Paul. And you're trying to get some rest. And at 3 a.m, the neighbor decides to throw all of his furniture in the front yard and fucking light it on fire. And this is your neighbor. And then he proceeds to dance around saying, "I'm Jake Paul, Team 10 Army bitches. I'm coming for you, bro."
They should call his show or shtick or whatever it is, it should just be called Blue Balls. Because it's set up like the beginning of a Jackass bit where like something cool is going to happen.
Yes.
The one that I saw was he's on this 2-stroke motocross bike. So it's like a 250 2-stroke bike. And it's like, bah, bah, bah. that, but he's in this tiny little LA front yard, right? So imagine it's like a 10 by 8 yard with this tiny little postage stamp pool. And you're like, all right, if this was Jackass, something really cool would happen. Like, he would jump over the pool and land in the sliding glass door, and Steve-O would go to the hospital.
And then they would hit him in the face with a cactus
right.
as he pulled the glass
right.
from
and
himself.
Then they would, yes. And then they would shove a toy car up his bum and send him to get an x-ray. Like, something awesome would happen, and then like, a hive of bees would get thrown on them while they're locked in the limo. These were the things that we grew up on, the bread and butter, like, real material. What this Donkey Lips does is he sets up that bit. Like, he gets the taser, or he gets the 250 two-stroke bike. And then what he did in this case is it was just like, bah, 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 and then he just goes, burp, and rides it into the pool. Just like falls into the pool. There was nothing cool about it. It's just like, you ruined the bike, and now the pool's polluted.
I don't get it.
10 million views.
Somebody, please. Somebody that has either the mind of a 12-year-old girl or children. Someone explain this to me and email us, because I do not understand the appeal.
Well, your daughter's six. Could we ask her?
Oh, I don't want to expose her to this kind of creature.
I hate to tell you, John, she's already watching this stuff.
Oh, I sincerely hope
they
not.
They start the kids early on this.
He's got an intro video when you go to YouTube and
my
click on his thing.
My name is Jake Paul, and this is my channel.
It's jazzy.
I was born on January 17th, 1997 in Cleveland, Ohio.
Oh, I think that's the bike that went in the pool.
Oh, that's not him doing a wheelie, though. No way.
That's some stunt driver.
Yes.
The first social media influencer to be a series regular on TV.
So he gets awards for being a douche. Oh, he put sticky notes all over the inside of his house.
Oh, that's going to take like an hour and a half to get that down. That could lead to slight residue.
My parents named me Jake Joseph Paul, and I was a savage from day one.
I am Jake Joseph Paul, and I was a savage from day one. Allow me to read you some lyrics of his hit song. It's every day, bro. Yup, y'all can't handle this. Y'all don't know what's about to happen, baby. Team 10, Los Angeles Cali boy.
He just said he was from Ohio.
Oh, but I'm from Ohio, though, white boy.
Thank you for clarifying, Jake. He just took that.
I'm a Cali boy, but I'm from Ohio, though. Fantastic lyric. Yeah. It's every day, bro, with the Disney Channel flow. Every hardcore rapper references their time.
The Disney Channel flow.
With Mickey.
Yeah.
5 mil on YouTube, never done before. That rhymes with flow. Mm. Tattoos just for fun. I Usain Bolt and run. It's every day, bro. It's every day. I said it's every day, bro.
I'm sorry, how often does this occur?
It's every day.
Oh. And who are you talking to?
You, bro.
We need to emulate this young man's tremendous success. So here's what I'm thinking. First off, we need two first names. We're both going to bleach our hair blonde.
Can you be Connor John and I be John Connor, like the Terminator?
Ooh, I like that. Okay, that's good. But they wouldn't get that reference because they're 12, and that movie came out 30 years ago.
Okay.
Why don't you be Jake and I'll be Paul?
Yes.
Okay?
You're Connor Paul, and I'm John Jake.
Perfect.
Okay?
At any point, can we have Zac Efron on our show?
We already said YouTube is not about porn. Just because you're...
You knew
where
I was going with that.
You're
so I'll be honest with
wants.
You. I'll be honest with you. Zac and I had a great thing for a while, but I'm really more of a Dave Franco kind of... Yeah, I'm pretty solidly in Dave Franco's camp now. Are you pulling up pictures of Dave Franco?
No, I'm pulling up his song, It's Every Day, Bro.
I thought we just did that.
We did, but I need you to see it.
Oh, boy.
And hear it.
That house is oh, my God. That house is amazing. Who are those guys? Oh, are those the twins?
I like how they didn't color correct his acne in that first shot. You got 20 million bucks, but you can't afford Proactive, you bitch.
It's every day, bro, with the Disney Channel flow. 5 mil on YouTube in 6 months, never done before. Pet all the competition, man, PewDiePie is next. And I'm popping all these checks.
Is this ironic?
That's the problem.
Is any of this ironic?
I want there to be some level of self-awareness that he realizes what a hemorrhoid he is.
I mean,
but he's not going to.
I haven't delved deep enough into his catalog of amazing media to know if he ever like winks at the camera and says, I know that this is a joke, but I'm making a ton of money off of it. Does it exist?
No, never. If he was a comedian and doing this as a bit, he would be the greatest comedian that ever lived. But no part of him is self-aware. If YOLO was a person, it is Jake Paul.
Yeah.
I want to be this big of a tool. I feel like I have it in me, but I need someone to foster that inner tool.
We need douche lessons. Does he offer a service?
What is the douchiest thing you could do to train to be this big of a douche?
Sit around all day on a Wednesday watching his videos.
That's solid. That is a solid start.
So I think you're through phase one, John.
Okay, I've got to have a posse. Who can be in our posse?
Ooh.
They've got to be all subservient. I've got to be the alcohol-bloated kingpin.
Yeah, that's the thing that's kind of fun, is like he has this group of, I presume, high school kids or college kids that he pays.
Yes.
And they all treat him like he's royalty, which I guess in their world he is. The guy's got a $10 million house and a sweet ruined dirt bike, so I would probably treat him the same way. We need that.
I need acne. We need to smear some pepperoni pizza on my face every night before bed.
I'm pretty sure I have the weird skin disorders covered.
That is true. So you can be Logan Paul. Logan Paul is the one who wore a minion outfit to a Japanese suicide forest, where he proceeded to make fun of the people that had committed suicide in his minion outfit.
Yeah.
Yeah, because this is what these people are like on the inside.
No, I mean, that's when they graduated from just traditional internet douchery to like full-on international offensive behavior.
So in case you want to be more dismayed with what's happening with society, I looked up some articles, and according to the Daily Mail, in 2009, a study was conducted in the United States, and they asked children what they wanted to be. Prior to this study, the number one items were pretty typical jobs: teacher, firefighter, doctor. You know, the standard ones that your kids say. No, now it's number one, famous. So it's not an actual job. It's just famous. Mm. And then when you drill down on that, it's sports star, pop star, or actor, respectively.
God, you know what's depressing about that? Is it's like we have a generation of kids who are going to grow up trying to compete on reality TV shows, basically failing.
And those are the biggest douches.
Basically failing, and then in their mid to late 30s, starting some kind of podcast out of their basement.
Some of this is ringing strangely biographical.
Did that sound familiar?
It hit a little close to home. No, because the problem is there is nothing here. And in fact, in the study, they also asked one kid, well, what is the goal? What is ultimate fame? And he said, 1 million YouTube subscribers.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, well, what would you do? He goes, well, I'd have 1 million subscribers. Like, no. What would your talent be to get the 1 million subscribers? Well, I would just have a channel. And they kept asking the question, and there was no there.
Mm-hmm.
So there is nothing there. I feel like it's some sort of self-validation sickness with the young people these days, where they have to get the likes on the Instagram, they have to get the likes on the Facebook, and this proves that somehow you have self-worth. And if you're trying to get self-worth from external sources, like how many YouTube followers you have, first of all, I should commit suicide, because we have like four. But it really is, it's going to... How many people are actually going to get millions of YouTube followers?
Well, we could all follow each other.
A tenth of 1%?
Do you remember those studies from the 80s when science was trying to determine what the deal with cocaine was? And they would put rats in these cages where they could push their snout on this thing to get cocaine, but it would like electrically charge them. And they did this with like 50 rats. And after 2 years, they come back with their clipboards and they're like, well, Steve, we've discovered that cocaine is delicious. And that is basically what social media is like. Maybe you're different, but I put some zinger on Facebook and I am refreshing every 5 seconds. Like, did anybody like it? Why didn't people like it? Is it not funny? I should edit it.
You know, it's 100% true. And I heard a great, I think it was This American Life. And they talk to some teenage girls, and there's this whole process, I guess, that they go through where... as you said, we could all like each other, and that's basically what it is. It's a big incestuous circle where, because you have to, you only feel validated if you get, it's like constantly setting the bar higher. You have to get to take the selfies and you have to get the likes. Mm. And so because they all need it and they're essentially free to give out, they all give it to each other. So what happens is they'll take a photo
and then they'll post it, and then they'll text our Snapchat or whatever it is, all of their friends. And all of their friends, if they're good friends, have to then go like it, whether they give a shit or not. And they all do this constantly. And so this is why they're always on their phones, because it's the rat with the cocaine. It's they're needing the fix.
You need that fix, yeah.
And so they're having to constantly do it for their friends. And it's really disturbing. We joke about what big douchebags these people are, but a lot of these people, and my kids are going to grow up in this world, and that's a little bit disturbing.
I mean, I don't want to be too much of a get off my lawn type, because I'm sure the washed up 30-something-year-olds when we were kids were like, have you seen that jackass? Oh, that's terrible. The kids are all going to grow up and put cars up their butt. and we turned out well.
I don't want to get too far off topic here, but I actually think, and maybe we should spend more time on this another time, because we do have a guest that I want to invite in here. But I actually believe that a lot of the school shootings, and I think that a lot of the this thing that happened with the guy that was part of the incel group, which a lot of people have probably heard about by now, which is the involuntary celibacy, where this guy drove over a bunch of women in Toronto because they owed him sex and they didn't give it to him, so they should die. And I feel like people are doing this now. People can argue over, and it's such a hot button topic, about guns, this or that, but people are doing this with cars, are doing it with bombs. So put the gun debate aside. People are doing these mass
casualty
events.
Yeah.
And if you take a step back and think about it, what is the goal? The goal is fame. The ultimate goal for a millennial that feels unvalidated and pushed down by society is fame. It's the biggest fuck you. The ultimate thing is going viral. I feel like the mass casualty events are due to this YouTube generation. I think it's the fact that they want to fuck up at full speed so that everyone knows how pissed they were, because that is the ultimate win. I went viral, and I may be dead, but I went viral.
I mean, I think you should be cautious about ascribing that to any single cause. It probably does contribute. I mean, if you think about terrorism, it's sort of a similar construct in the sense that you are trying to attack a more powerful entity with the limited means at your disposal. And so the way to garner attention, not to yourself, but to your cause, is to do something that is dramatic and upsetting and that makes people nervous and fearful in their own environment. I mean, that's sort of the political construct of, let's do something dramatic to get attention. And yeah, I suppose you could ascribe a similar psychology to a kid who, you know, has a mass shooting or something along those lines.
But think about this. We didn't have incels. So a little background. An incel is a group of men that have gathered on the internet in forums like Reddit and 4chan and so on. Basically, it's involuntary celibacy. They hold the world accountable for the fact that genetically they cannot get laid, and they blame women and yada yada. We all couldn't get laid when we were teenagers. This is the story of my life.
I still can't.
You figure it out when you're 12. You're grumpy. You're trying to get laid. It doesn't happen. 12-year-olds go self-gratify. This is what they do. They don't go out and kill people.
Well, how old was the guy that conducted this?
I don't know. I think he was in his 20s, early 20s or something like that. But, I mean, I don't think the majority of our friends probably didn't get laid until into their late teens. And, I mean, they didn't mow anybody down.
Right. Well, that's kind of my point, is that no single cause is dispositive, right? I mean, there's a lot of things that contribute to this. But if you look at the rate of violence, the rate of homicides in the U.S., it's so far above other comparable industrialized countries. And I know you say you want to take guns out of this conversation, but it's hard not to look at that and think that's really the most influential variable. Sure, there are a lot of others. This idea that people want to get attention, whether it's for their political cause or their bizarre sexual cause or just for themselves, yeah, that's absolutely a factor. But fundamentally, the thing that I think drives the distinction in terms of the disparate rates of homicide between our country and other comparable countries is the access to guns.
It may be. I actually don't. I have some strong opinions on that, and I'm happy to go down that road. But I feel like I'm tired of hearing people speak about it. I personally am tired of speaking about it. So, you know, if we want to, we can talk about that for a full show. But right now, I want to bring in our guest.
Wait. Hold on. Is that you bring up the issue? I respond, and you're just like, nope, bring it in the guest.
This is the difference between being married and not being married, Connor.
You learn how to just dodge debates.
There are arguments and events in life that you know there will be no victor. There will only be argument and someone sleeping on a couch. I think, although we think highly of ourselves, we would have to be Jake Paul to think that we could solve a gun debate in this little
episode.
Yeah,
but we don't solve anything in here.
I get
that. Did we solve anything with respect to Jake Paul other than wallowing in our own just inadequacy?
I feel a little better about myself making fun of him.
I feel way worse. Are you kidding? I'm making fun of him because I'm jealous.
Basically,
guy's got 14 million followers in a freaking mansion.
But when does making fun of someone when you're jealous not make you feel better?
I guess that's the whole point. Yeah. All right. Well, then I do feel better. Thanks, John. You've made me feel better.
I'm here for you, Connor.
Thanks, buddy.
All right. At this time,
Thanks, bro.
Every day, bro. At this point, I want to welcome our guest, because now we're so professional that we have the guest wait while we have the first part of the show, and then we invite them in. It is with great applause that I would like to welcome friend of the show, knower of all things technical, herder of millennials, Christine.
Woo!
Your favorite whoop, Connor.
There he is.
Christine, welcome to the show. You are in tech sales, and thank you for being here. Thank you for waiting patiently while we talked about 20-year-old millennial douchebags. We wanted to have you in for multiple reasons. Obviously,
I have one big reason. Sorry to interrupt.
Well, no, please go ahead.
I had one big reason. It's like, I'm pretty gay and stuff, but this show was turning into a real sausage fest.
This is true.
It's like you and me sitting around talking about our small genitals, and then we would invite on other guys to laugh at us about that topic. And after like 6 weeks of that, I thought maybe we should bring a woman on.
To laugh at our small genitals?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. It's been a few years since a woman did that to me.
Now it's only guys.
Yeah.
I'm married, so the laughing has just gone to disdain.
Now it's like guys and tailors.
Christine, one of the reasons we wanted to have you in, as Connor mentioned, is it's important to get a female perspective, but you have the distinction of being a female that works in sales, which is kind of a male-dominated field for the most part, and also working with a number of Jake Pauls.
I work with douchebags all day long. Self-righteous, self-loathing, narcissistic.
I take it we won't be naming your company today.
We will not be naming my company.
Should we change your name to Professor X when we air this? Do you feel like you're going to the zoo when you go to work?
Pretty much. It's very similar. I mean, with regards to the people that I work with, they're anywhere from 23 to 27-year-olds.
How do you get through the day? Do you have an opioid addiction?
It's hard.
Just irrespective of your work and who you work with, just really, how do you get through? I'm having a hard time because like, I spent my day looking at Jake Paul videos and I'm feeling pretty bad about myself.
Do they come in on time? Do they have like me days where they just show up kind of when they want, and then there's like, you know, I was up on Skype with my French boyfriend until 3 a.m. and
I just
couldn't make it into work.
Yeah, I mean... Just, you know, the world revolves around them and I have to hear them.
So you guys have sandbagged me really bad today. I was not told that today's episode was going to be bag on the millennials. And I'm not
sure. Oh, I've got more too.
Oh, I'm sure that you do. I just want to let you know right now that you are othering me, that I was born in the end of 1981 and I am a millennial. Granted, when other millennials see me, they're like, go back to bed, grandpa, because I am the oldest of the old. I'm 36, and the youngest ones are, what, like 20? But the fact remains, I am taking a lot of offense right now. I am on Snapchat telling about how you two old people are making fun of us, and we're upset.
I didn't even realize how much of a suckfest your life must be, because you are actually a millennial.
Yes.
But you're an old millennial.
Yes.
So you don't even get to experience all the joy of being a young, responsibility-less, self-entitled bag of dicks.
Oh, no, I do all those things.
It's a bag of dicks, but I'm talking about being self-entitled.
Yeah, all of that. I feel entitled to a bag of dicks for myself. This is my bag, and you can't have any.
Actually, I think you are actually of the generation that is now being called Xennial. Have you heard of Xennial?
No, I am not. I am not. I am a...
No, because what the distinction is that, because I am slightly older than you, so I was born, I believe it's a Gen X.
Yes.
Gen X.
Can't you tell?
Yeah, I sound 12, so I should be whatever's after millennial. I am a Generation X.
Yeah.
The people born, I think now they're segregating it to like 1980 to 83 are now Xennials. As I understand it, a Xennial, the distinction is whether or not the internet basically existed when you were at some certain age. You were born technically in an analog age. So things like cell phones didn't really, I mean, the Zach Morris cell phone came into being when we were like 12 or whatever.
Yeah.
So something technically, like they're saying that the real millennial, a true millennial, was tech from day one.
Well, see, let me tell you why I don't buy that, because that is a that's a digital native. That's a different thing. There are a class, most millennials are digital natives, but those of us on the Ronald Reagan end of the millennial, what is it, generation? We are not digital. Like, I remember going into computer class where we used to do Mavis Beacon Teaches Typing and the Apple IIgs, and you had like number munchers where the little Pac-Man thing would go around and it was like 2 + 2 = 4. I remember the day they took us in there and they're like, guys, we're going to show you something that's going to change the world.
Oh, yeah.
This computer can talk to that computer over there. And then they would be like, all right, wait for 10 minutes and don't make any phone calls because it's going to dial up to another place and then call back to that computer. And we would stand up and be like, but I can talk to him. He's right there. I don't get it. I'm going to go play dodgeball.
Oh, and they don't even know what it's like to not know. I mean, when we grew up, you could not know something. Like, what's the biggest fish? Yeah. Who the fuck knows? Yeah. I wouldn't even know how to begin to find that out. And now it's like, bop, boop, beep, and there's the biggest fish.
You used to have the encyclopedias. Remember that?
Yeah, the Encyclopedia Britannica. But you know—
They don't know what that is now.
It's miserable.
You know what we did know, because I had several of these in my family, is the person who knew everything. And the person who knew everything could go unchallenged, because there was no internet to say, no, that's not right.
You could be like, you know what? I actually caught the world's biggest fish, because you can't find out. Fuck you.
I have a Polaroid of it somewhere in the attic. I can't find it. But trust me, I know. And I feel so bad for the people who grew up, you know, the generation older than us, who grew up as the person who knew everything. Like, they were the internet back then. And now they've had to adjust to a world with the internet where they're like, it's the mackerel. And then the 10-year-old sitting next to him is like, nope, it's the giant aquatic Galapagos.
Well, what's funny is even now, and I don't know if you've noticed this, Chris, with the people that you work with, I am super old school because I rely on email and spreadsheets. And they look at me like I'm from Mars, because everyone has an app. There's all these productivity apps. Like, if you want to develop an app, the progress is done in a specific app, and then ideas are done in another app. And then if you want to communicate with the person, oh no, you can't, as Connor said, talk. God forbid you pick up the phone. That's our parents' generation. But if you email, you're an old piece of shit too, because now the kids all do the apps and all
collaborative
this
stuff. Tools.
Yes, collaborative tools.
With your terms and stuff.
Yes, collaborative tools. So everything is either Slacked or you know, IM'd or send me something. In our company, actually, 200-person startup company, we're not allowed to have paper and a pen. So you can imagine.
Tell me you're kidding.
I'm not kidding. So
you're not allowed to have.
We're not
okay, what millennial,
even print.
What millennial put this rule in place?
This is a startup world, this open concept where your CEOs and CIOs, everyone's sitting right next to each other.
Open concept sucks. How am I supposed to watch Jake Paul videos during work hours if there's an open concept office? We had a few shows ago, we had a good friend of ours in, and he's now an attorney. And he told me a story, and I wonder if you can relate to this. It blew my mind. And again, I did more research, as I do after. He had this kid come in, and he said to him, he said, Phil, are you busy? And Phil's on a call, billable hours. And he's like, I'm kind of on a call right now. Well, I've got something important. Okay, so Phil gets off of his actual work call. The guy's like, you're like outdoorsy, right? And Phil's like, sure, what can I do for you? And he's like, I have a fireplace in my condo, which is, that alone is millennial. And I want to have a fire, but I can't get it to work. And he's like, what's the problem? You don't have any wood or what's, he's like, well, there's no switch. And this was straight faced. And Phil is like, no switch? And he's like, yeah, to turn it on. And he's like, okay, so if there's no switch, then it's probably not a gas fireplace. It's probably a real fireplace. He's like, okay, so what does that mean?
Wow.
And Phil goes, well, you're going to need to build an actual fire. And so you put logs in it, wood logs, and then you light it, and that will be a real fire. And so Phil thinks this is the end of his conversation. And the guy comes back the next day, he goes, interrupts Phil again while he's on a call, and he goes, yeah, it's still broken. And Phil goes, okay, the fireplace probably isn't broken, but what happened? He's like, well, then the logs are broken. And Phil's like, how are the logs? I can only imagine a Marine who's done tours in Afghanistan or Iraq. Damn it,
You got it halfway there. Fuck. One of these days, John, one of these days.
How blown their mind would be in this conversation. But he's like, okay, what did you do? He's like, well, I put the logs in, I lit a match, I put the match against the log, and the fire didn't start. And it's just like, I almost want to do the millennial hand on face or face palm, as they say. And finally, Phil had to explain like kindling and all this stuff. And it brings up this good point that is, millennials now lack basic life skills. Something like a quarter of millennials can't screw in a light bulb. They cannot change a light bulb. They task rabbit a light bulb.
They do that, but they also have YouTube channels to pretty much do things that they've never done before either.
Like putting for sale signs on their house?
Exactly.
Putting for sale signs on celebrity houses. I'm sorry, is this episode just going to be entitled Get Off My Lawn? Are you guys just going to sit here and make fun of probably the only demographic that would struggle through listening to
our
show?
A lot of them remind me of you, actually.
Yeah, I know. That's why I'm getting offended.
Connor, I have hatred in my heart.
Yeah, I can tell.
And if nothing else, this show is a vehicle for both my narcissism and my hatred. Okay, here's the difference.
You're making fun of them just because they're doing it better than you.
Well, he's scared for his children, right?
No, he's not.
Yes,
don't bring
is.
His children. No, he's
I'm
not.
I'm agreeing with her. I am scared for my children. Damn it, that didn't work.
You have sound effects on an iPad.
Connor, there's a huge difference. There is what's called being self-aware. I am aware that I am a tool and a narcissist.
Yes.
They are unaware.
They lack that. Absolutely.
And in your line of argument, that is the only distinction, is that you commit all the same behavior, but you're aware of it, so that makes it okay.
So here's the difference. The oversensitivity. Put too much perfume on, you're basically, bothering me. We're sensitive over that. Or someone actually got fired for saying something to a girl that had to do, and I don't know what it was exactly. Mm-hmm. They didn't share that, but it was something so simple. It wasn't anything severe.
Obviously, the Me Too movement it's gathered a ton of steam right now. What is that like? Do you feel empowered by the Me Too movement? Do you feel a little bit pissed off because you're like, you've got your battle scars from dudes being full creepers?
Oh yeah, for sure. I mean, there are things from, the VP putting his hand on my ass, or another boss of mine that drove me around, show me places with his hand on my knees. But
what?
But you know what? There are things that happen and we put our big girl panties on and we deal with it. I think the Me Too movement is great, and I think there are legitimate cases that should definitely be addressed. But then you have the people that just take advantage, and those are the ones that I absolutely despise, because I think that they basically mess it up for everybody else. So that oversensitive over everything, like, oh, you can't say black, you have to say African-American, or you can't say this, you have to say this.
You get in trouble for saying the word black now?
Yes, absolutely.
I mean,
oh,
I knew that you could always be,
you can't say black. That's the thing. It's like, oh, you can't say this.
Is that like when my grandfather says Oriental?
Yes, you can't say Oriental.
I'm out of debt. Well, I know you can't say Oriental. My great grandmother used to say colored. Like, we would be at the dinner table and she'd be like, oh, I met the nicest colored gal. And you're just like, you can't say that. But I didn't know you can't say black anymore.
That's the thing. It's like, you can't say black. That's not proper. Don't say that.
As far as I know, that term has not been used as a racist term. I completely understand with the N-word. Completely understand with saying colored and these things, because those were terms used to be racist.
Right.
But the term black, as far as I know, hasn't been used as a tool of racism. It doesn't mean there wasn't racism. I just don't know that that was the specific vehicle. Connor's looking at me. Connor, you're pretty woke. So am I totally off base here? I'm trying to be honest and open. I could be a huge raging racist, but I just kind of treat people with face value based on their character. So I'm just kind of being honest.
I mean, I would punt on that.
Well, you're in politics, so you have to always punt.
No, actually, I'm gonna pivot is probably the better verb. I studied metaphors, the construct of language in our society, because language evolves and there are built-in metaphors and meanings that we don't even consciously recognize. Look at the difference between black and white in the English language. So there's a black mark on my resume. We blackballed that guy. We got a black eye from that incident. It's almost exclusively a denotation for negative. And you look at white. The great white hope, white lightning, candid, actually, I think is from the Latin for white, pure as the driven snow, all of those kind of metaphors where white is elevated as a positive and black represents the negative. And it's this construct that perhaps it wasn't racially designed, but that is the linguistic construct in which we exist. And so that plays into a sense that there is something negative associated with being a person of color, and there is something sacrosanct or preferred about being a white person. And so is the term black necessarily offensive? On that, I would punt. I don't know. Is it necessarily directly grounded in a racist use? Historically, probably not. But I think it's important to be conscious of the broader context there. The other point I would make is that Martin Luther King at the time in his speeches used to use the word Negro. And that, I mean, that just was the nomenclature of the time in the 60s. And it's funny now people will quote him and they'll change it. Which
I don't
agree
with that at all.
I think it's kind of interesting. I mean, it's hard to evaluate language from the past based on the contemporary standards, because the meanings evolve, language evolves.
You have a very valid point that I had actually never thought about as far as the association of the color black being negative and the association of the color white being positive. Valid point. I think when someone is simply using a term, if you're looking at the intent, did they intend to be racist? If someone uses the wrong pronoun, were they intending to put you down? Were they intending to be offensive? If the answer is no, then shut the fuck up. Yes, we should all be better educated and we should all know things. But I mean, you've got places like Canada that are trying to make it a criminal offense to use the wrong gender pronoun. That's insane.
Well, I would add one other thing. Yes, intent is very important, but impact is important too. And if you can make a credible case that the impact of what you said was detrimental to somebody else, then I think you ought to evaluate whether or not you should say that.
But that's just it. It's so sensitive. Everything, it has a strong impact.
Well, that's why I qualify that as saying a credible case. Some of the cases aren't credible. Sometimes people are offended for things that are illegitimate, but sometimes they are legitimate concerns.
Well, I think you run into a problem when you're judging what someone says by how it's interpreted by the person hearing it. That can get a little bit dicey. In my opinion, you can kind of only judge people on what they actually say, and maybe not criminally, but socially judge them on the intent. Anyway, there's nothing people love more than a couple of white guys sitting around solving the world's race problems and determining how people of color interpret various phrases. I want to get back. Chris, we were actually chatting before the show. You said there's some crazy stuff that they're eating, but you didn't tell me what. What's going on at the lunch table?
I'm honestly like all these drinks and the crickets, containers of crickets. That's other
containers
thing.
Of what? I'm sorry, what?
Crickets.
Does somebody have a lizard?
Like dead
like pets?
Crickets.
What?
Dead, no,
dead
like things, sustainable food that they tried. These
they, I'm sorry, they eat
dead crickets?
No, they do not.
No, I do not. People sit in your 110%. Office and eat dead crickets. Somebody has a pet lizard.
I actually have a picture of this. I actually will pull up a picture
of this. Okay, maybe we can put this on the site. So you are telling me, God's honest truth, there are people in your office eating crickets as hors d'oeuvres.
Yes.
Fried bugs.
They are, I don't know what they are. They're big canisters of crickets, a huge canister, like a Costco size. And they will sit there and snack on it all day.
No way.
And you're like, what are you doing? Oh, well, these are sustainable foods and we have to eat this. It's like, are you fucking for real?
Have you tried them?
No, I haven't
they're
tried
rich
them.
Rich in protein.
Why would
I haven't tried them. I would love to try them.
When
you're rich
real
in protein.
Food.
I ain't eating you.
Well, true.
That sounded way grosser than I intended it. But
wow.
I can't believe they actually eat the crickets. I've heard of the cricket protein and I've heard and I can somehow wrap my mind around if it just looks like protein powder and someone tells me it's a healthy form of protein,
yeah.
I can wrap my head around that. It's gross and I wouldn't want to think about
why
it.
Why is it gross?
It just feels gross because it's The grossest part is the antennae.
Those are kind of gross.
You see crickets with the like, and the antenna have like independent movement, and they're not picking those off. Those are getting ground up with the brains and the eyeballs and the taint. There's little cricket
butthole. You're concerned about cricket taint.
There's a tiny, tiny little cricket butthole in that.
You
in
eat
that
hot dogs?
Because
you've been having some large buttholes.
A not so tiny cow butthole in my hot dogs. But that is I am used to eating cow butthole. I am not used to eating.
So you know how we
butthole.
Do the, you know how we do the sound bites at the beginning of the show?
Like, yes.
With John, yours today is going to be, I'm used to eating cow butthole. And people will listen and be, oh, in context, that made sense.
On that tasty tidbit, we are running up on an hour, and I'm being told we are overdue for a break. So let's take a quick break. Christine, you want to stick around? And when we come back, we'll have Connor's news.
Wildcard is brought to you by
Coinbot. Access cryptocurrency pricing and market information right in your Slack or Telegram group. To add Coinbot for free to your group today, please visit coinbot.co. One more quick thing before we get back to the show. If you enjoy any Wildcard episodes and you think this podcast is worth continuing, then go ahead and tell a friend. I know it may not seem like it, but this kind of drivel actually takes a lot of time and effort to cut together and to put out. So if you could share it with someone, help us grow. Also, please, 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 go to iTunes, take less than a minute to review the show. Just write up a few quick sentences, submit it. This is how people are going to find the show. Anyway, tell a friend, tell a neighbor, write a review. Now back to the show. Okay, welcome back to the show. Thanks for sticking around. Chris, thank you for sticking around. And now Connor's favorite part of the show, probably because of his theme music, Connor's news.
Did it, did it, did it. Yes. We need to cut about 10 seconds out of this.
Yeah.
I am a fountain of knowledge on a wealth of topics.
So today in news out of New Jersey, it turns out the Garden State remains a figurative and literal shithole. A local high school in New Jersey repeatedly discovered human feces on their track and football field. And finally, upon installing a camera to try to catch the masked feces caper, they discovered that the offender was none other than their very own superintendent, who has now been placed on paid leave.
The super pooper.
Why paid leave?
I don't know.
Wow.
I read that too, and my favorite part of that article was the fact that he was charged with indecent exposure.
Yes.
And littering.
Littering. They charged him with littering.
Because you know they're going through the book, where is shit on the track? Where is shit on the science building? It's like, there's no law for that.
What but can we littering. Get him on?
It is littering.
I think by that rationale, if he had squatted over the garbage can, it wouldn't have been a criminal offense.
Oh, that's great. Is that compostable? Or do we recycle that? I am absolutely perplexed by those fucking bins. I went to a thing with my kids the other day, and I was perplexed because I bought food. And the food came on these plates that looked like they were hippie plates. And then I get there to throw stuff away, and there's three trash cans. Trash is passe. There's landfill.
Landfill.
You scum, horrid human being. If you put anything in landfill, you got to look to make sure no one's looking at
you.
Yeah. And then there's compostable. And then there was something that was the color of the recycling bin, but it said like bottles and cans and clap your hands. And so I'm sitting there, and I am utterly perplexed because I've got what looks like plates made of sustainable bamboo pulp.
Mm-hmm.
And then I've got knives and forks that appear to be made of some form of congealed butter.
Mm-hmm.
And then I've got the leftover food bits.
Mm-hmm.
Where the hell do I put those things?
That all goes in the green bin, bro.
But then what goes in the landfill?
Nothing. We're zero waste.
What if it's plastic forks?
Well, you shouldn't be using those because...
What if you didn't have a choice? They're at a restaurant.
How am I supposed to know if the fork is... congealed corn syrup or an actual resin fork.
That's tricky, actually. But the truth is single-use cutlery is not really recycled anyway. So I always throw it in the recycle bin because I'm like, geez, well, maybe they'll figure out a way to recycle it. But I think most of the time it actually gets sorted out and thrown away, like your plastic fork and knife. The truth is you shouldn't be using them. I
don't have options.
Am I getting earthy and preachy? Because
you see this? You see what he's doing? This is exactly what he's doing.
What, did I care? Did I care about the earth?
I can change the world. It starts with me.
Oh,
no,
God.
You can't.
Oh, bro, I'm too busy.
We're going to get hit by media.
I'm too busy to be bothered to try to care about anything or the earth.
I'll give him my kids for a day if I trusted him.
You guys, I tell you, you gen whatever you are's.
So I went on that big tangent about the garbage, but back to superintendent pooping.
I used to live in the marina in San Francisco, and I had a friend that would come over to my house, and the first thing she would do is go poop.
That is gross.
Yeah,
that is rude.
My husband was like, that is rude. What the hell is her problem? Why does she always come over? She lives right down the street.
Does she have a boyfriend? She wouldn't shit in front of the boyfriend?
No. She lived by herself. She had a nice place, and she lived like 4 or 5 blocks down the every time.
Would she come over solely to take a shit? Because that's really rude.
I don't know what it was.
Would she at least hang out a little bit and fake it? Or would she just be like, nope, I had some bad tabbouleh. I'm in and out.
She would make no excuses. She would go in, and then she would be in there for a little while. But she was fast, you know, not as short as pee.
Oh, wow.
And she would leave it. And my husband's like, why don't you ask her? Why don't you say something to her? Like, why do you poop at our house?
When your husband was there. That is so awkward.
Yeah. He's like, why don't you ask her?
I wouldn't go into
that.
Are you sure she wasn't in there like rifling through your meds?
I'm 100% sure.
Did you have
sure.
like an OxyContin prescription and there'd always be a couple of pills lighter?
No, because it would smell like poop after she. That's how Mike found out.
Well, maybe that was how she was masking that she was stealing drugs.
No.
We are keeping it classy today. Well done, us. Okay. If I can, again, make one of my awkward transitions. I do have a game. We're running really tight on time, so maybe we'll only have time for the first few. And I think Chris is going to be very good at it. I think Connor, like most things in life, is going to be terrible at it. Do you speak millennial? And I wish I had some sort of jazzy do you speak millennial intro.
How about I do it? Do 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 cha.
That was very Gen X.
Do 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 do. That's Mario Brothers.
You got to bring up a rave sound.
Oh yeah, you're right.
All I've got is my game show music, but it's not really a game.
Yeah, we've used that.
And it's kind of overplayed. So.
All right. Let's just get right into it.
I do have the game show thinking music, which always seems a little bit intense.
Yeah, it makes me nervous.
All right. We're going to ask Connor. Connor, when a millennial says, "Oh my god," and I'll put it in a sentence. Okay, the word is fubbing.
Okay.
Fubbing. Oh my god, I'm so offended. You're fubbing me right now, aren't you? Or you're, maybe not me, maybe you're fubbing right now. I'm kind of winging these sentences because I don't really speak millennial. So.
Language of origin?
Douche.
Fubbing. Yanking my chain.
Wow, you just got in the way back machine for that one.
you're pouring my sarsaparilla.
How about, maybe you can get this next one, and then I'll ask Chris if she knows what, well, we'll stay with fubbing. Chris, do you know what fubbing
is? Chris, for the steal.
Fubbing.
My wife does this to me all the time, and now I can say with staunch masculinity, honey, stop fubbing.
Judging you?
Close.
Faking climax.
No, she doesn't even bother to fake it anymore. She just asks, are you done yet? Fubbing is when someone is texting or typing on a computer while talking to you.
Ooh.
Basically not giving you the attention.
You're fubbing me right now.
Yes.
Interesting. Oh. Okay.
Or I don't know if, again, that's why I don't know if it's fubbing me or just you're fubbing.
Yeah. So in our day, that was like talking on the landline while you were on the toilet.
Okay.
No. What?
No, I could see that. When you're on the party line, but you've got something going on, and you're going to have to go. Oh, the party line. You ever rocked out on a party line?
So
Chris, you rocked out on a party
1-900
line.
1-900 number?
No, not 1-900. That's this kind of music.
Not that kind of 900 number. The party line.
Yeah, the party lines. Were they 900? I don't remember.
Yeah, they were 900 numbers.
And what did you do
on
there?
You get to talk to other people on the call.
It's the original AOL chat room.
Yeah, it wasn't porn
or anything.
You
would just call into and there would be like a bunch of people on there.
It's a party line.
Party line.
How did it not just end up in a cacophony of different people making weird sex sounds? Like what was the chat one?
Well, you're like 10.
Chat roulette. Where the idea was you go on with your webcam and it's just going to, it's like every 10 seconds, it's going to switch you to a different person that you're going to web chat with, right?
I don't remember
this.
No, I've never done that.
This is a few years ago. So pretty much within 2 days, it devolved into everybody was just showing their wang. It was like
the roulette would go.
No wonder Connor remembers.
The roulette would go, and it would be like da 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 wang, and then you'd wait 5 seconds. Da 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 wang.
How many hundreds of dollars did you put on your college credit card when this first came out?
Chat roulette. I can't believe you guys don't remember this.
Shockingly,
it's like
I do not remember a program that randomly showed me men's penises on the internet.
That's Snapchat. That's Snapchat today.
It is kind of Snapchat.
I don't
basically
snap.
every shared human experience ultimately devolves into showing wangs. Think about it. What is the most common piece of graffiti? Not really graffiti, but like scribbling that you see anywhere. What is it?
It's penises.
It's penises. It's absolutely penises.
They are the giver of life.
I'm sure Freud had a theory on this, and I'm sure he was like, oh, it's about poo and cocaine and your relationship with your mother. But there is some psychological reason.
Sounds like a party.
Right? Get that on the party line. There is some psychological reason why people always draw penises.
Connor, I will use another millennial word in my amazing transition.
Please.
You feel Hondo P about this. I need my music. It feels awkward to be quiet.
Hondo P.
Hondo P.
Could you spell that since?
H-U-N-D-O space P.
Not Hondo P.
Hondo.
You said Honda.
It
like
is
a
not,
Honda Accord.
Sorry, Hondo P.
John's not so good with the words and the letters.
It is not a character in Street Fighter 2.
Yeah, E-Honda.
It is a millennial thing.
So Hondo space
as in,
P.
I'm not sure.
Is this one of Bradford's clients?
Call back.
Thank you.
Chris, do you know what Hundo P is?
I have no clue.
It is 100%.
No, it is
not. Do you want to go?
Oh, wow.
Do you want to go
Hundo
and take
P, I do, bro.
Do you want to go eat some crickets and take a selfie? Hundo P.
Hundo P, bro.
I've never Hundo heard of Hundo P, but I've heard of Hondo.
I think I'm saying it wrong. Keep it 100.
It's like
100. I've heard keep it 100.
Like Hundo. Or do you want to have a convo? Have you heard of that?
Oh, yeah, that's painful. Ugh. The shortening of the word.
Or bae.
Shorten the
oh,
word.
God.
Bae due to a messaging...
Apparently,
I'm sorry,
bae is out.
It's autocorrect. No, it's still in.
Is it not?
Bro is for the boys and bae is for the girls.
I'm really, really tired of the I can't even
the
this period.
I hear that all the time.
I'm so tired of it.
Wasn't
so
I can't even one of the names that we almost went with for this show?
No, absolutely not. It probably
was
suggested by Jim. The great thing is because I am self-aware of what a douche I am and you are, in addition to the millennial word game...
I'm not sure it counts as self-aware to just call me a douche.
In addition to the millennial game, I actually looked up a bunch of what our words were where we were
nice.
In the 90s.
Nice.
And they are absolutely as bad. They go word for word with the millennials.
Let's play that game.
Yeah, that actually would be a good game. I think that maybe we'll put that together for a future episode. But right now, we are running up over an hour, and it's that time to review and see what, if anything, we have learned today. Some may say that we have accomplished little this episode, but I beg to differ. We have spent the better part of an hour making fun of millennials. I almost feel like it's a public service, if you will. We are making ourselves feel better. We are making society feel better. Without us, you might be tempted to watch a Jake Paul video all the way to the end thinking that something wicked awesome was going to happen, and now you know that it won't. I want to thank Christine for stopping by and spending this time with us, teaching about collaborative tools, the nutritious qualities of cricket anus. On that note, I will leave you with this gem.
It's everyday bro with the Disney Channel flow.
Thanks for listening to Wildcard. See live podcasts and pics from the show on Instagram and Facebook, or visit us online at wildcardshow.com.